TheYeshiva.net.
Welcome to our class in Talmud Dvorah, the Palm of Dvorah by Rabbi Moshe Cordovero, class number 4. This class is dedicated in the merit of Binyamin Yisrael Chaim Ben Chanita for a complete and speedy recovery and many long, happy, healthy years together with his parents, B'toch Kol Choli Yisrael V'Noimar, Amen. So Rabbi Moshe Cordovero introduced us to the idea that the human being can emulate the divine, not just in his or her physical posture, but also in my spiritual, emotional, psychological posture, in my day-to-day behavior. I can emulate the 13 attributes of divine compassion, Yud Gimel Midas HaRachamim, in my life. In the previous class, he discussed the first attribute, intimated in that verse in Micah chapter 7, Micha Perek Zayin, Mikael Kamoicha, who is a power like you, describing the fact that even though Hashem observes and sees everything, furthermore, He is the one who is responsible for the continuous flow of energy that allows my body to function biologically. Because how does the body function? The body functions because the heart is giving it, constantly providing it with the circulation, with the blood and with the oxygen that it needs, that the brain needs and that the body needs in order to be able to live. And that includes at the moment that I'm using my arms or my legs or my mouth or my mind or any other part of my body to do something which may be inappropriate, which may be immoral, which may be promiscuous, which may be hurtful, which may be forbidden. So I'm using the divine energy to betray God. Nonetheless, Hashem will not seize the flow. I'm taking this arm of mine and I'm using it to steal, God forbid, or to hurt somebody. I'm using my mouth to lie or to be deceitful, to be dishonest, or to gossip, or to slander, or any other organ or limb that I am employing, and using the electrical current that is being generated by the continuous divine flow. I'm using it against Hashem, but nonetheless, He will not seize to give me that energy. And this is the attribute that the Ramak, Rav Moshe Cordovero, calls savlanut. He has the ultimate tolerance and patience to be able to allow people to figure out their lives, to make amends, to learn from my mistakes, and ultimately discover what the truth is and return to my own core truth, to my divine truth, to God. And this is something I ought to emulate in my own life. We ought to emulate in our lives as mirrors of this divine attribute, Mikael Kamoicha, in this world. Now Rav Moshe Cordovero takes it one step further. Hamida HaBeis, we now come to the second attribute, which is indicated in the continuation of the above Pasuk and Micha, Noisei Avon. Noisei Avon means he bears iniquity, or he carries or contains sin. V'areza gadol mehakoidem. This is even deeper than the previous state of consciousness we spoke about. Sharei Layasa HaAdam Avon. There's no reality that a person does a sin and it does not create some form of negative, toxic, destructive energy. Like the Mishnah says in Pirkei Avos, the ethics of the fathers, somebody who transgresses even one sin creates one kateger, literally one prosecutor. And what this means is that every person in my actions, every action I do, every action I take, every word I say, it creates an energy. It has an impact. There's a real reality that I create and I craft through my words, through my thoughts, through my actions. That's why we have that expression, the famous expression of the Tzemach Tzedek, Tracht gut, ved sein gut. Think positive, and the results will be positive. Because my thoughts, my attitudes, my perspectives, my paradigms, the energy I exude into the world through my thoughts, my words, and especially my actions, they really create a reality. This is true about positive actions, and this is true about negative actions. So he says, when I do something, when I say something and I do something that's wrong, it's hurtful, it's toxic, it's immoral, it's promiscuous, it's contrary to the design, to the blueprint that the master of the world has given me, has given us how to live, this creates a mashchis. It creates around me a toxic, negative energy. And this energy, this prosecutor, as it were, oimid lefnei HaKadosh Baruch Hu, stands before God, and he says, ploini asa'ani. I am the product of this person's actions. You know, this, in other words, whatever I do has consequences. I can't hide from myself. There is testimony in the world to everything I emit, I create. There is testimony because there's an energy that's existing as a result of my actions and my words. Whether positive, as the same Mishnah says, you do a mitzvah, you create an angel, a positive angel, means a positive force and energy. And that energy is alive, it's vibrant. Even if it's invisible to the physical eye, the retina cannot absorb it and testify to it, but the spiritually sensitive are aware of it. It says, when Yaakov came into Yitzchak, he felt paradise. When Esav came into Yitzchak, he saw purgatory opened up below him. Because we create the energy in which we live. There's a halo of light or darkness that surrounds me. So as a result of that, whatever I do, reality testifies to it because there's a real energy in the world. And this energy tells God, I'm a product. I am a product of this person. Ve'ein b'riyam eskayemes ba'olam ala b'shifa shel HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Now, there is no creature that endures and exists in the world only through the divine flow of Hashem. Now, this destructive force, this destructive angel or this toxic energy stands, it exists. How does it live? It also needs oxygen. There's nothing in the world that can exist without oxygen. Whether it's the physical oxygen we're used to, we're inhaling, we're exhaling, or there's another form of oxygen, but something has to give it a force, a current, an electricity to allow it to live. How does this destructive energy, this angel, continue to live? Hadin noisim, it would make sense. Sheyemer HaKadosh Baruch Hu, God says, Eini zon mashchisim. I'm not going to continue to feed toxic energy that was created by somebody's bad choices. Yelech etzel misha asoy v'yisparnes b'menu. Go to the one who made you, and get your food from him, get your oxygen from him. And then v'hoya amashchis yoyred miyad, and then this destructive energy would descend, v'noytel nishmasa, and he wants to feed, he wants to live. Take the soul of the one who created him, I karsa, I cut him off, I nena shalav kefiyanshe, she's batla amashchis ahu. Or he should get penalized and punished until this destructive energy ceases to exist and therefore doesn't need life. V'ein HaKadosh Baruch Hu oisekei. God does not do this. Ela noisei v'soivelav, and he himself carries, contains, tolerates the sin. And just as he feeds the whole world, and he continues to oxygenate and give vitality and vivify every single creature that lives in this world, organic life and inorganic life, everything. He continues to noiseyavin, to bear this iniquity. Noise means to carry, to hold on to it. Not just to give the person energy, even if he's using energy for that sin. Even post the sin, he creates that negative angel, a negative energy. God will feed it. Until one of three things happens. The person who sinned returns, he repents. He goes back to his or her original core. And as a result of that, causes the toxicity and the negativity to be destroyed, to be eliminated, b'siguvav, through his own mortification, through his own remorse. Or the ultimate true judge will nullify that destructive energy through the various pain that the sinner may experience, or ultimately through his passing, or even after his death, he may go through the cleansing process of purgatory, v'sham yifrachayv, and there he'll pay back his debt. V'hainu sh'amar kayin, this is what kayin, the first murder, first homicide in history, is a brother kills a brother, Cain kills Hevel. And he tells God, Gadol avoini minesai. My sin is too great to bear. And our sages see it as a statement with a question mark. Gadol avoini minesai. Is my sin too much to bear? Or Pirshu Chazal, our sages explain this verse in Bereshis, Medrash Tanchuma. Bereshis Tess, I think. Kol ha'olam kulo atasoivel. Besides my sin, Kayin told Hashem, you contain the whole world, and my sin you can't contain. What do they mean? What did Kayin say? Kol olam kuli atasoivel, the whole world you contain. What does it mean you contain the world? Yirtza, zonam afarnes. What Kayin meant is, you sustain and give parnasa, you give life and vitality, animation to every single thing in the world. V'avoyni kavet, besides my sin is too heavy for you, she'ena tayachal esavloi. You can't hold on to it. You can't contain it. Pirush lefarnesai. You can't continue to sustain it. Atcha asha vasake, with the patience until I realize that I have to repair my own life and get rid of the toxicity that envelops me and surrounds me. And indeed, God concedes to Cain's request. Imken areza midu savlonas gdoila. This is an excessive, extraordinary attribute of tolerance. Sheyozunum afarnes birir rosh abarachayti atsheyashiv. That God is ready to sustain and feed that toxic creature that the sinner created through his or her actions. A spiritual creature, not a physical creature. Atsheyashiv, realizing a person needs to sometimes fail and fail again until they realize how to create a much better life for themselves and emancipate themselves from that toxicity and get rid of it. And God will continue to feed this. And that's very, very powerful. It's very painful. It comes from a deep place of a lot of confidence and belief in the person. Yilmid ha'adam. I can emulate this in my life. Let a person learn kam letzorach sheyeh savlan. The power of savlanut, the power, the confidence it takes, the belief it takes, and the depth it takes to be able to really tolerate, to be able to learn this attribute. Lizbol ol chavere, to be able to contain. Lizbol means to contain, noise, to carry the yoke of the other person. Vera oisav, and even the toxicity, the negativity. Shahiriya, which he did. He did bad things. He did the wrong things. Atshir kazesh adayre asa kayemes. It's not just he did it in the past. Sometimes the aftermath, the consequences of that negativity still exist. As spiritually, we spoke about the angel, the mashchis, the kategor, the prosecutor that exists. And sometimes shechata negdoi. It was something towards me. It's not something towards somebody I don't know. Something towards me. And there's the aftermath of that. V'hu yizbal. Can the person have the savlanut, the ability to contain it, to tolerate, ad yisaken chavera, until his friend will become more aware, or his colleague, or his family member, or somebody else will become more aware, and fix what they did, or until that point, that it's nullified by itself through different processes that happen in the world, to be able to have that savlanut. Now, it's so important, I think, to make a disclaimer here, because I know the feedback I get from people. Sometimes people mix this concept up with allowing abusers to continue to abuse. You knew that I'm going to say this, right? People sometimes don't realize what the Ramak is saying. He is not talking about doing something that will allow evil to prosper. You're not going to stand by idly at your brother's blood. If somebody is doing something to abuse you or somebody else, of course you have to stop it. You shouldn't have savlanut. You shouldn't tolerate something that's happening immoral, that's destroying other people's life. If somebody has a gun and about to shoot, savlanut, they'll have to figure it out on their own. No, then I become an accomplice to the killer, to the abuser, to the murderer. What he's talking about here is emulating God. You see, sometimes if your savlanut is coming from a place of horrible inferiority complex, and you feel that you're a shmat. Somebody once told me, it's very hard to say, he was abused and molested for around 6 years, from 6 to the age of 12, by 4 different people, family members and non-family members. And he said it created a paradigm in me that the only way I can be worthwhile, the only way I'm worth something is if I become the target that people can abuse and abuse. Then I have dignity. Then I have value. God forbid to confuse this with these words of the Ramak. The Ramak is saying, emulate God. God doesn't think he's a shmata. God is infinite. God's confidence is infinite. God's inner strength is infinite. This is coming about a savlanut that's coming from strength, not from weakness. From inner spiritual confidence, not from an inner sense of mediocrity. From knowing who you are and who the other person is and realizing that they're going through a process and I want to be able to tolerate them and contain them until they can realize what they did, because I hope and I believe that they'll be able to recover. You see this especially sometimes with children. It's very easy to say, I'm not going to support you anymore until you figure yourself out and become a tzaddik. Now, sometimes some borders and distance is the right thing, but very often I take away all the energy I'm giving them because you're using it against me, using it against to do the wrong thing. And we cut off the relationship and we don't allow them ever to grow. So in attribute number 2, he says, continue giving the person what they need in order to hope and hoping and believing in them and helping them reach that place where they can ultimately one day recover their true dignity. And here he says, sometimes it's even more noisy of it. Sometimes I'm actually dealing with the aftermath and the consequences, but I hold on to it. I contain it because of my profound savlanut, my profound tolerance to emulate God who believes in every single person, even if they sometimes don't believe in themselves. Thank you.
This class is brought to you by the yeshiva.net. Please help us continue the classes. Make even a small contribution at www.theyeshiva.net/donate.